Hello students, welcome to the next class of history. I, Purushottam, welcomes you in the medieval India. Now the fourth unit of our class 7 history, that is the elevation of medieval India. Till now, we have seen the periodization of Indian history. We have seen various sources for reconstructing the history. Now, in those sources, for reconstruction purpose of history, sources are divided into two types. One is archaeological survey sources and other is the literary sources. Now, in archaeological sources, archaeology means study of past remnants of earth is called as archaeology. So, remnant material, things which are present on earth, since past are studied in the archaeological sources. In that we have inscriptions, epigraphy, numismatics, and literary sources. These are the sources which are in the form of writing. So, last time we have seen the literary sources, the biographies, autobiographies, chronicles, indigenous literature comes under the literary source. Now, in this period, we will be mainly focused on the political development of India during medieval time, religious development of India in medieval time, economic development, and social development. Along with the last unit, that is the middle age or medieval age of the Europe. So, basically, now we are entering into the medieval India. And this period will give you glimpse of medieval India politically, economically, religiously, and the society of the medieval India will study in this period. Now, political development, during early medieval period, before the early medieval period, we know that the Gupta dynasty, Gupta kings were at the paramount, and we have the Harshavardhana that comes in the ancient time, during start of the 8th century, during the early medieval period, there was a struggle between three regional empires, that is, Pratihara Empire, Pala Empire, and Rashtrakuta Empire. Now, among those, the Kshatriya clan of the people, who nowadays is called as Rajput, emerged as victorious, and the great king Prithviraj Singh Chauhan is from the Rajput clan. Now, after the early medieval period comes late medieval period, which is the invasion of Muhammad Ghazni. Muhammad Ghazni defeated the Prithviraj Singh Chauhan, and after that the Muslim rule could establish in India. So first invasion by Muhammad Ghazni, and second the Muhammad Ghori. These invasions by the Turkish led to the foundation of Delhi Sultanate. Now Delhi Sultanate, we have Dev dynasty also, right? Then when the Delhi Sultanate started disintegrating, then emerged the Mughal Empire. First Babur, Humayun, and then Akbar. So Akbar could consolidate the Mughal Empire in India, and later on the Mughal dynasty was established in India. Now, when the Mughal Empire started to disintegrate, so after the Aurangzeb, there was no potent ruler present in the Mughal line, Mughal Empire. So as the Mughal Emperor started losing his control over different Indian territories, various regional powers emerged, like the Marathas, Sikh, Jat, and Mahuls. We know that the Maharashtrian Marathas, Maratha Empire, we already know that Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj has laid the foundation of Maratha Empire. So he initially struggled against the Aurangzeb. Then Chhatrapati Sambhaji also led struggle with Aurangzeb. And as Aurangzeb gave more of his time in the later part of his life in Deccan, he could not have control over the northern area. So when Chhatrapati Shivaji died, Aurangzeb saw an opportunity to consolidate his empire in the southern India. In order to curb the Maratha, he entered in Deccan and thereby he lost control on the north side. That's why the Mughal Empire started to disintegrate, and that gave not only Marathas a chance, but Sikh, Jat and Ahoms also got a chance to establish their own kingdom in their own territory. So that's how the political development of the medieval time is taken place. Now from this slide, we are very clear that back then, during the medieval history, India was not politically stable. There was political chaos happening around India. We had the three Hindu kings fighting together, and the Muslims establishing their kingdom, the power, Delhi Sultanate, and then Mughal Empire, right? And then after Aurangzeb, the Indian power emerged. So medieval India is a kind of chaotic politically, right? In which there were no stable governments given to the Indian state. Now, among that, let me say the great Akbar was a king who tried to stabilize the Mughal Empire in India, and he thought himself as a king of India. He resided in India. That's why Mughal could establish themselves in India, and later on, the Mughal Empire or Mughal architect, all those Mughal art forms could develop during the medieval time. Now, second is economical condition of the medieval India. Well, this slide shows you that the one of the person is doing agriculture over there, because the agriculture was a main occupation back then, right? And today also you know that the India is an agricultural country, because 60-70% of Indians get directly or indirectly get a job from the agriculture. That's why agriculture is important today also and back then also. So agriculture was the most important business back then. That's why due care was taken to map the agricultural land, and on the basis of the land, on the basis of fertility of the land, on the amount of the land and amount of crop produced, the revenues used to get fixed. Because state, the main earning source for state was the revenue. The taxes which are collected from the people, from the citizen, are the main source of the money for the government. Government needs money to from the administration, to maintain the army, to maintain the police, right? And from where government gets money? From the taxes which are collected from the citizens. So during medieval time also, government's main source was the revenue. So revenue was very carefully mapped. So lands were mapped, and the revenue was fixed on particular land. And again, with the help of say modern technologies, like the one that we have seen here, the spinning wheel technology. Those technologies made life easy for farmer. Now in this slide you can see that the spinning wheel technology is used to get the water out from the well, and the irrigation is being done into the farmers. So modern technology was used for the farming. Farming was a main occupation, and being prosperity at the time, there were many craftsmen developed, many business of making ivories developed back then. So economically, India was very sound back then. Before the arrival of Britishers to India, India was really, really sound in the economy. That's why we regard India as a golden spiral of the medieval time. And due to the business, due to the trading with the international people, India was earning lots of money. Some of the commodities which were commercially important, like our spices, the silk that was produced in India was amazing. The textile, the Dhaka textile, that is said to be, you can go that entire sari, you can keep the entire sari in one matchbox. So that type of fine textile was being produced in India back then. So economically, India was sound in the medieval time. Now, religiously, now in early medieval period, we have seen that the kings were Hindus. Then in late medieval period, most Muslim ruled all part, but most of the Muslim rulers were religiously tolerant. So there emerged lots of movement which were engaged in increasing or enlightenment the people. So during the start of medieval period, or before the start of medieval period, last year we have seen that people were not happy with Hinduism. So Buddhism and Jainism emerged as alternative for the Hinduism in the ancient period, by the late ancient period. So in early Vedic period, there was a revival of Hinduism with the start of this Bhakti movement. Now, Bhakti movement is a devotional trend emerged in the medieval Hinduism. So many saints like Sant Namdev, Sant Vaishnavai Chaudhary, Kabir Das, these sons come together and they revive the Hinduism. Right? We have Adi Shankaracharya, who gave the one God principle. Right? So, religiously, India was tolerant back then. It gave chances to emerge various religions. Hinduism was revived in the form of Bhakti movement. We have Sant Daneshwar, Sant Tukaram, a Maharashtrian son who has contributed to the Bhakti movement. And by the fading away of Islamic materialism, new trend of religious emerged as Sufism. Sufism emphasized on introspection and spiritual closeness of God. So in Sufism, there are samas instituted, organized. This is the mystical movement with the help of Qawwalis that we see nowadays. With the help of Qawwalis, God was praised and the love towards God was shown to the Qawwalis. So we have lots of gharanas of the Sufism. The main guru we used to call as Peer in the Sufism, and the student was called as, he was just a devotee in the Sufism. Now, third religious movement arose is Sikhism, which believes in the teaching of Guru Nanak and his successors. Guru Nanak said a universal principle. Here I can read, Ek Omkar Satyanam Karta Purakh Nirbhav Nirbhay Akal Murti Ajni Sabham Guru Parisar, which means that God is one. He is the real. He is the true. He makes and he is fearless and he is tolerant to everybody. Right? And who is shapeless? Right? He is beyond this ephemeral. He is beyond the death and birth. And if we take his name, if we worship him, he will give blessings to everyone. So Sikhism has also emerged during the same time. How Indian society was back then? The society was divided into aristocrat, priest, peasant, trader, nobility, officers and soldiers. And new groups such as craftsmen and artisans emerged. We are going to do that. Prosperity was there in medieval India. Economically rich peoples live there. So that out of desire gave birth to different group of peoples like craftsmen and artisans. Subclass such as potters, weavers, goldsmiths, musicians emerged during the same period. But the thing is, human condition deteriorated in the medieval period. Very inhuman practices such as sati emerged during the medieval period. Saying this, I should also focus Razia Sultan, who was the queen of Delhi Sultanate, who has taken over the dynasty from his father and who could rule. But as she was woman, there were lots of conspiracies occurred against her. and she was ultimately killed. So a kind of deterioration has been seen in the woman's condition, though women were able to inherit the property rights from the father, but that was confined to the ruling class only, for the upper class only. Last, the global connection, we see the European Middle Age. Up till now we have seen medieval India. Now medieval India started from 8th century to the mid 18th century, right? But the European Middle Age starts from the 5th century to 15th century. So for 1000 years it lasted in Europe. And it is also called as Dark Age. Because in ancient Europe, there was the rule of Roman Empire. Roman Empire gave chances for the science to flourish, arts to flourish, but with the decline of the Roman Empire started the Middle Age of the Europe, where there was no value given to the discoveries and art. That's why it's called as Dark Age. The medieval Europe age is still the Renaissance of the Europe. Renaissance literally means rebirth. So after the 15th century, there started various revolutions, they started to talk about the science, they started to talk about the art. It's the same period, medieval period, in which Black Plague occurred. It's the same pandemic that we are facing today of COVID-19. But this Black Plague pandemic was so huge that it actually reduced the population of India. They occurred in the 13th century. So it was, plague is highly contagious disease and it's highly fatal disease. And back then there were no medicines available. It killed many people. And the medieval period in Europe is the same where there was birth of Islam by Prophet Muhammad. Now, I hope that this lecture was useful for you. It completes our first unit of class 7. If you have any doubt, please feel free to ask me. And meet you in the next interactive session. Till then, stay safe and stay home. Thank you.